Well, hi everyone. I'm Andy Asher. I'm editor here at Bloomer Boomer. Now, May is Mental Health Awareness Month, and it's a good thing that we bring attention to it because there is a lot of stigma and there's embarrassment about mental health. I mean, you know, tell someone, for example, you have a headache, and there's usually some compassionate concern. They might even give you an aspirin to help you with it. Now, say that you're depressed or that then you might get kind of an awkward silence. So let's talk about it. We could have invited a mental health professional to discuss Mental Health Awareness Month, but instead we're talking to a woman who has suffered many hardships from mental illness. She is Suzanne Ludlum, who describes severe depression and multiple suicide attempts. Later she explains how she overcame her demons with the help of mind-body practices. We'll learn what she means by that. Professionally, Suzanne is a yoga therapist who has undertaken a personal mission to help us all open up more about mental illness and take it out of the closet with her new book right here. It's called The Imperfect Pilgrim, Trauma and Healing on This Side of the Rainbow. First though, let me get a plug in for BloomerBoomer.com, if you will, or if I can. It's about optimism, idealism, and it is about realism, about life's challenges, whether it's loneliness or the surprises that life brings to our mind and body, or depression. The message is simple: embrace age, empower dreams, embrace life. Now, we would love it if you subscribe to our YouTube channel and our lively Facebook page, live events around the country, and some other cool things. And you can also get our newsletter. So check us out. We'll be right back with Suzanne Ludlum right after this. Well, our guest is Suzanne Ludlum, and her book, it's called An Imperfect Pilgrim, Trauma and Healing on This Side of the Rainbow. Suzanne, I want to thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Andy. It's my pleasure.
You know, for someone watching this show who feels unhappy and depressed, who hears us say that there is reason for hope and healing, you know, they'll probably turn us off, convinced that we really have no idea how dejected they might feel and even curse us about that. You know, when you feel that low, words of inspiration actually sound kind of empty.
I agree completely. Unless you have experienced the depths of clinical depression and suicidal ideations, you really cannot literally understand what it feels like. And emotionally, it's devastating. Mentally, you're numb, and physically, it hurts as well. Early when I fell into a very deep depression when I was 21 for the first time, when I was 21, after losing most of the members of my family, I didn't know what depression was. I just knew that I felt awful. And I didn't have many people around to ask me, are you okay? Is anything wrong? No one really took the time to sit with me and hold space and say, what's going on?
It's kind of a shortage of that around. You don't find too many people that have the courage to ask those kind of questions.
And that's right. And I believe the reason why people are very afraid to ask those questions is because they're afraid of the answer. Mm-hmm. They're afraid that if the person they're speaking with starts talking about their pain, that somehow it's going to be contagious and they'll start feeling the same way. Or they just simply don't know what to say. There are lots of well-intended people who want to help people who are in pain, but they just don't know what to do and they don't know what to say. I was told by casual friends, you'll snap out of it. Oh, it's not that bad. And it was that bad.
Yeah, that's the thing that can drive you totally crazy when people don't recognize the seriousness of it.
Right. Right, and it's very serious. We know this. We absolutely know this. Yeah. There are 44,000 suicides in this country alone every single year. And if you average that out to per state, that's almost 900 people taking their own lives in every state of this country every year. My goodness. To me, that's an epidemic.
Well, you know, I've gone through your book. and you have lived in a painful emotional life. Now, your book really details all of it, and I know it's nearly impossible, but can you recap for us to help us, you know, fully understand where you've been and how far you've come?
Sure. Well, like I said, my traumas really started when I was probably before the age of 21, because my family was pretty messed up in some ways. They loved me, but they were very dysfunctional. And then one by one, they all died, except for my brother. And by the time I was 21, like I said, I had fallen into a really deep depression because of the era and because of the general attitude of mental health and mental illness in that time. There was still a strong stigma and a lot of shame around how I was feeling. And so when I went to my first therapy appointment, I told no one, not anyone. And that was a mistake, because the therapist had his own agenda, and he subsequently assaulted me. So that even exacerbated my depression. That was another trauma put on top of the pile that I had already experienced. And so I sunk deeper, deeper, deeper into a darkness that I really thought with all my being was completely unrecoverable.
That is mind-boggling.
If I didn't share my story, my descent into mental illness, as well as my ascent out of mental illness and the pathways that I discovered to heal, then my life journey would have been for nothing. I have to share it with people, because if I found myself at that bottom, that darkness, that abyss that was so incredibly painful, it was without words. It was so bad, it was without words. If I could find myself there and yet find my way out with a lot of help from well-meaning therapists and mind-body practices, as you mentioned earlier, I really truly believe that other people can find their way out too. And that really is my life's mission at this point, is to get the conversation started, to just not be afraid to reach out your hand and say to someone, are you okay? Can I help you? Is there something wrong?
Talk a lot about age here, because hey, we're all over 50 at Bloomer Boomer, and that is not necessarily define who we are, but if there are unique aspects to it. Now, if I can ask your age?
I am 59 and a half.
Okay, so my point, the reason is I'm asking that, as we get older, we can really no longer, you know, kid ourselves about mortality. I mean, we're all experiencing the death of family and friends. Our mind and body are not necessarily what they once were. In fact, not necessarily, they aren't. And those are not mental problems of our own making, they're real. And it's hard, and in some cases, it feels impossible to overcome.
It does. And yet, every day is another breath. Every day is another opportunity. Every hour, sometimes, if we're suffering, taking it one day at a time is too overwhelming. There were times in my life where it was literally one breath at a time. And as we age and as we grow older and our children leave the nest, maybe our friends move away, our parents pass away, maybe some of our friends pass away. We see our world seemingly getting smaller and smaller and more isolated, but it doesn't have to be that way. That's why it's so important to connect yourself with community, whatever community you can find. It could be a club, it could be a senior activity, it could be a yoga class. Hey, here's a concept.
Yeah. Well, you've really given us some great, great tips. Tell us how you overcame your demons with the help of mind-body practices. And tell us a little bit about what that means.
Well, I need to first preface this by saying that yoga and mind-body practices did not heal me. Prozac really got me out of that deepest, darkest pit that I was in. I credit medication and good psychotherapy with really pulling me out and helping me to become functional. At least I could get out of bed. At least I could take care of my kids. At least I could go to work. mind-body practices were something that I discovered while I was already on that upward trajectory of healing. And what it does for me, and what it did for me then, and what it does for me today, and it is an everyday practice for me, is it keeps me grounded. It keeps me calm. It keeps me engaged with the voice of my true self. Because when we're depressed, our mind plays tricks on us, and our mind tells us stories that we believe because that's the only thing that we have come to listen to. But those are the stories of the conditioned voice. They're not the stories of the true voice. So what mind-body practices, yoga, including yoga, meditation, self-inquiry, all of them, just general mindfulness, what they do is they help us really keep in touch with who we are underneath those stories, underneath those false senses of identity that we've come to attach to ourselves through our suffering and through our depression, our anxiety, or other, you know, other modes of mental illness.
I really admire the courage that you brought forth to talk with us and to write your book. I think it would really help other people.
And that's why I did it. It was a very, very difficult story to write because I had to live it all over again. Memoir writers really do live twice. Mm. You live it the first time and then you write about it and you really do relive it the second time. But it was something that was bigger than me. And it was something that had to be done. It was a story that had to be told because I believed with all of my heart that if I could share my story and my journey, it will help other people.
Indeed. This being Mental Health Awareness Month, and as we wind down, and for people who might see some hope here, what might be some, you've given us some great tips already. I really like those. Anything else people might launch out on to get started?
If you're hurting, if you're suffering, find someone you can trust. And it just has to be one person. And don't be afraid to say, I'm hurting, I need help. And if that person is not a good connection for you, find someone else. There are a ton of resources out there. There's Mental Health America. There's the Suicide Prevention Hotline. There are all sorts of senior groups. If you live in an 55 and over community, you can call your clubhouse and say, hey, what are some of the activities going on? Get out of bed, take a breath, get out of your house, get into nature. Our bodies resonate on a very subtle cellular level. We resonate with the energy that's out there in the world. So get into nature. When I'm having a bad day, I walk out my back door and I go down by my lake and I sit by the water. And after 10, 15 minutes of that, I'm okay. I feel it.
I hear you on that one. It makes all the difference in the world. Well, Suzanne, thank you so much. Our guest has been Suzanne Ludlum, and her book, An Imperfect Pilgrim, Trauma and Healing on the Side of the Rainbow. Suzanne, thanks so much.
Thank you, Andy.
We'll be right back. So I hope you liked the show, and I hope you learned a thing or two. The full show is going to be available on YouTube and at Bloomer Boomer. Now, we do have some other shows coming up, so I want you to join us if you can. Please like us on Facebook and visit us over at BloomerBoomer.com. Until next time, so long.